In 1991, Street Fighter II had hit the arcades, and it totally revolutionized video games as we knew it, creating a brand new genre of video games, known as the fighting game genre. You get it? It hit the arcade, because, you know, fighting game. Yeah. Now, it is true that many games that fit the specifications for a fighting game were around long before Street Fighter II. Street Fighter II was the game that made one-on-one fighting games the thing they are today. And honestly, it's one of my favorite genres. Now, many fighting games have come and gone since the creation of Street Fighter II. One of those games is a little-known series that never left the Japanese arcades. That series is Azure Blade. And honestly, it's a real pity it never got any fame, because Azure Blade is fucking awesome! Azure Blade is a really well-polished game. It looks and plays fantastic and reminds me of kind of a cross between Guilty Gear and Street Fighter, gameplay-wise. It also has a rather dark atmosphere that's kind of like a less silly Darkstalkers. Unfortunately, I can't read Japanese, but from what little I've been able to find out, some baddie named S. Geist has gotten a legendary weapon called the Azure Blade, and you must stop his insane reign of terror or something by beating people up, because it's a fighting game. Final boss is a legendary troublemaking blade? Nah, never heard of such a thing. So this game has a small but pretty well-designed cast of characters. Let's take a quick look at him, shall we? We got Yashel, who kind of looks like Soul Bad Guy's nerdy little brother. Next, we got Goat? Wow, nice name. I don't know why he's named that, but I recommend not making fun of it. He's one of the strongest characters in the game, and he will fuck you up. Next, we got Zambi. Yeah, that's his name. And as the name would imply, he is in fact undead. You'd think that would give him an unfair advantage in the fight, but it doesn't. He also has a huge claw arm, kind of like that guy in Samurai Showdown. You know the one. The green guy? The one with the claw arm? The ugly guy? Yeah, him. We have Taros, whose name is probably a misspelling of Talos, which was the name of an ancient golem of legends. But, you know, Japanese has this issue with R's and L's, and the worst part about calling him Taros is the fact that it puts him one letter away from being a Pokemon. Taros, I choose you! Actually, no, I don't. You suck. Rosemary, who has a cool floating demon sword, and is probably happy this game never took off, because if it did, she'd probably fear the pictures of her floating around on DeviantArt. Also, the music for her level is one of the best tracks in the game. Just take a listen. Footy. Footy. Well, with a stance like that, she might as well be called Booty. Am I right? Yeah, there goes my last female subscriber. Lightning, this must take place before he got a sex change, you know, the one he needed for Final Fantasy 13. But hey, we gotta respect his life decision. His level music also sounds like an 80s power ballad. I mean, check it out. But you know what? Fuck all those characters, because you should play as Alice. Alice is probably the best fighting game character in existence. She's a little girl with the power of necromancy. That's right, she's like 6'8", maybe? And she commands the dead. How fucking awesome is that? And if you need any more proof that she's a badass, just listen to her level music. Not convinced yet? Well, just check out some of her moves.
Show me a moves!
She can call upon the dead to give her opponents a skeleton uppercut. Ow! Make skull shields, and even have a skeleton give her opponents some head. And then there's her awesome super cranium smash! That's a whole lot of head. Also, you can do a more powerful version of your super moves by hitting two buttons instead of one, similar to how Darkstalkers in Street Fighter 3 does it.
Spooky, scary skeletons and shivers down your spine.
So you can also do this.
They see me rolling, they hating.
Whoa, Is that zombie checking out that skeleton's ass? What a pervert. One of the many things you can do in this game is fling your enemies across the screen and they bounce off the invisible wall at the end of the screen. This looks both hilarious and horrible when it's done with Alice. They definitely make it look sillier with her than the other characters. Probably to soften the blow that you're beating the shit out of a small child. So yeah, I was able to kick the ass of all my opponents pretty easily thanks to how badass Alice was. That was until I got to my shadow. But with some persistence, I was finally able to beat my shadow. Shadow boxing to the nth power, motherfucker! So I thought I was on my way to the final boss, when I learned that there's one more guy before the final boss. So before I can fight S-Geist, I have to fight the sub-boss, whose name... Curfew? Why in the hell did they name him that? I mean, I know Alice is kind of out late for her age, but hey... Holy shit, what the fuck? Did that guy just bring a gun to a knife fight? Or a magic duel in Alice's case? Out of all the cheap... Son of a... Ugh! And I'm not shitting you. Curfew is fucking cheap as shit. How cheap? Kind of like mixing Cable from Marvel vs. Capcom 2 with Omega Rugal from King of Fighters 98. I.e. he has a really cheap projectile move coupled up with some really cheap AI that knows how to use it.
Viper Beam.
But I'm determined to get some footage of S-Geist, so I will defeat this blasted Curfew. Let the montage begin! And I couldn't do it. Sorry, everyone. I know I failed you, but I just couldn't beat this cheap son of a bitch. No matter how hard I tried. And oh god, did I try.
Oh my god, did I try?
Well, regardless of the boss's cheapness, Azure Blade is fucking badass. And I highly recommend it. Especially if you can get a second player to play with you. It's a real shame it didn't get a US release, or even a console port for that fact. This game had the potential to be a real contender, but unfortunately it came and it disappeared with little notice. Too bad that despite all of her awesome necromancy skills, even Alice couldn't raise this game from the dead. Ah, Namco, makers of such well-known arcade classics as Pac-Man, Dig Dug, Galaga, and Splatterhouse. Wait, what? Yeah, the same guys who made us games about a police mouse taking on a gang of cats, and several games about shooting space bugs made an arcade title that was a complete homage to slashers of the 80s. Quite a drastic change of pace from their usual titles, eh? The only thing I can think of that comes close to this from Namco's library at the time was maybe, I don't know, Rolling Thunder? And that was a spy plot about multicolored Klansmen that takes itself seriously in comparison to, you know, a game about a yellow pie eating fruit and ghosts. But even then, it's a completely different beast. It's not even remotely close to being the gore-encased burrito that is Splatterhouse. And despite its darker theme, Splatterhouse is still considered a lesser Namco classic, making cameos in other Namco titles, and even getting a PS3 and Xbox 360 remake in 2010. And the remake, I hear, was... okay-ish. I never got to play it, but hey, it's got Jim Cummings as a terror mask. And that's both awesome and surreal. I mean, this is the guy who voices Winnie the Pooh and Darkwing Duck.
Who am I? Let's just say I'm God. You're God. At least the only God that's listening right now.
Wow, the terror mask kind of sounds like a less cartoony Naga Duck.
And without me, you're fucked.
But we're not here to talk about the remake. We're here to talk about the original 1988 arcade title that started it all. The story of Splatterhouse is simple enough. Rick Taylor and his girlfriend Jennifer Wills are running through a forest, and they come across a mansion and decide to go into it. Why would they randomly go into this spooky mansion, you ask? Fuck if I know. It does kind of look like the Addams Family house. Maybe they were hoping to get John Astin's autograph. That guy was pretty fucking awesome. But upon entering the house, you hear Jennifer scream and... Next thing we see is Rick laying unconscious as he gets possessed by the ghost of Jason Voorhees!
Oh, but he's back! He's the man behind the mask! And he's out of control! He's back!
Okay, it's not the ghost of Jason Voorhees, but man, that still sounds like a better plot than Jason Goes to Hell. Also, get used to seeing him laying like this. You're going to see it a lot. But yeah, it's not Jason Voorhees, but an evil mask called the Terror Mask. That just happens to look like a hockey mask. You know, not unlike Jason Voorhees. Granted, I don't think Paramount Pictures or New Line Cinema can put a copyright on a hockey mask. I'm sure this was meant to be a homage to the popular Friday the 13th slasher movie series, but I guess it got a little too close for comfort, as the mask looks less and less like a hockey mask with each sequel, eventually looking more like a weird kind of skull mask. Either way, in trade for putting on the mask, Rick is given superhuman powers and goes on a mission to save his girlfriend and escape this monster-filled mansion that wears the word body horror like a dress. Splatterhouse is a beat-em-up style game, but not in the style of Double Dragon, but more in the style of Kung Fu Master. And what I mean by that is it works on a 2D plane where you only move left and right in comparison to the typical 2.5D perspective of most beat-em-ups. Also, like Kung Fu Master, most of the normal enemies only take one, maybe two hits, while bosses take several hits and are typically the most difficult part of the game. This also means Rick has a very limited amount of moves, no combo system, no hit stunning, and very simplistic gameplay and controls. Just simple punches and kicks is all Rick needs. How dull. But I guess when you got the power of the Terror Mask, you don't need much, huh? Fortunately, this game did pick up one thing from other beat-em-ups, and that's the ability to pick up and use weapons that you find laying around. To be quite honest, my favorite part of most beat-em-ups. This includes such weapons as 2x4s, shotguns, and a butcher knife. That oddly makes the sound of a bat hitting a baseball when used. It's a home run! The crowd goes wild! Rick is really ahead of his opposing team! Too bad Rick never gets a machete in this game, but that might be taking Rick's obvious homage a bit too far. Honestly though, the gameplay in this game is pretty basic, maybe even too basic, as it can get pretty dull, and the action can get rather repetitive at times. Dude, Rick, there was obviously a ladder there. Why'd you feel the need to jump down? I mean, you don't even know what was down there! Ah! Also, Rick has what has to be one of the stiffest and most awkward jumps in video game history. The animation of his legs bending don't even seem to happen until he's already off the ground. What the fuck? It makes me wonder if Rick's not really jumping and the Terror Mask is just giving him some weird half-assed flying or bouncing ability. Anyways, what this game lacks in expansive gameplay is made up for in visuals and atmosphere. The look and feel of the game still holds up well today, with all the spooky music and gory graphics continuing to give you a solid 80s schlock horror movie vibe. The game also adds a lot of neat effects, like lopping off the heads of enemies with the butcher knife or splatting enemies against the background with a 2x4. Jeez, no wonder they call this game Splatterhouse. As simple as these effects are, they still manage to add a little bit of fun to the overall experience of this game. The game also has some pretty creative bosses, like this meat-filled room dominated by these grotesque worms. Alright, I think I got him off. Fuck! And a room where you're attacked by pretty much everything in it. Okay, I think I got him all this time and— Ah, fuck! And this bag monstrosity with chainsaws for arms, simply called the Biggie Man. I can only assume they meant Boogeyman and got confused in translation. Either that or they were just trying to say that this guy's no biggie. Except, he is! Because no matter how hard I try, I can't beat this motherfucker! Oh yeah, and this game is really fucking hard! Especially doesn't help that Rick is slower than a constipated shit. He walks at a very leisurely pace for someone who's trying to save his girlfriend and trying to get out of this haunted mansion. Also, all of his attacks are extremely telegraphed, especially when he uses a weapon. This makes attacking foes a matter of precise timing, even when dealing with some of the most basic of mooks. Rick looks less like he's dying and more like he keeps falling asleep in the middle of battle. Who knew Rick was a narcoleptic? You'd think a Terror Mask would have fixed that. Need coffee. It is at least a nice touch that after you die, your next life starts with Rick waking up at a checkpoint and picking himself off the ground. Man, what did I do last night? And with all that said, you might be asking, is Splatterhouse a good game? And I'd say it's pretty good. The gameplay feels dated even by 1988 standards. but the aesthetics and feel of the overall product makes up for a lot of its lacking areas, though this also gets brought down a little by how frustratingly difficult the game can be. And as much as I like the slasher movie look of the game, I can't help but feel the game would have never gotten any attention if it didn't have said graphics and music style, because the game does kind of lose its appeal once you get past these little flourishes. So despite being inspired by B-grade movies, I don't feel like I can give Splatterhouse anything better than a C. It may not be the best game, but hey, it's still a cut above the majority. Aw, look at this little guy. Isn't he just the cutest little monstrosity you've ever seen? I'm like not sure if I should hug him or stab him with a spork. Regardless, this is Mutron Kun, and he's the star of the 1987 arcade game Mutant Knight. Mutant Knight is an interesting take on the run-and-gun style video game, and the fact that Mutron Kun has a very limited range weapon and all of the levels take place in narrow corridors with almost no platforming. This makes learning enemy patterns way more important than most games. It also causes dodging enemies to be just as important, if not more important, than actually shooting them. So you pretty much spend each level shooting or dodging enemies and getting to the trapdoor to advance to the next level. Like most games, it's way more difficult than it sounds. Wow, this game has a lot of balls. Wait, I've used ball jokes way too much. Look at all those, gumballs? Damn it! Another interesting feature in the game is Mutron Kun's ability to jump infinitely. That's right! Fuck your double jumps and your triple jumps! Mutron Kun can jump forever! Who says white men or things can't jump? This is extremely beneficial because some of the later levels will actually have no platforms, or at least very few platforms, in it, requiring you to jump almost infinitely through the entire level. I will say for a game from 1987, it's very visually appealing to look at. The strange backgrounds have a lot of detail to them, and the icons for your lives actually kind of dance around a little. The enemies are also pretty interesting too. In fact, the first 10 levels I saw robotic apes, those spinning tiles from Xevious, Robo Pac-Man, a giant Robo Pac-Man, and a robotic Marshmallow Peep. And let me tell you something, that Peep is a fucking asshole! Happy Easter, motherfucker! Fortunately, our strange hero does have some power-ups to help him out, like a spread shot, the ability to send out duplicates of himself, turning into a bunch of little Mutron-kuns, and my favorite, turning fucking gigantic. Becoming a giant of this size is actually pretty impressive for a game in 1987. Not to mention, Mutron-kun did this long before Mario pulled it off in New Super Mario Bros. Shove that up your pipe hole, Mario!
Hey, shut up, you face!
Also, there's this cool little robot dragon that'll help you. Wait, is that a robot version of Bub from Bubble Bobble?
It is! It's fucking Bub!
Look, I know I joked about the enemies looking like Pac-Man and a Peep, but this actually looks like Bub! Man! Tato gonna sue!
So, overall, Mutant Knight is a fun, strange, and challenging little arcade game that I actually really enjoy. Due to the limited level designs, it does admittedly get a tad repetitive after a while, especially since the game consists of 62 levels in total. For the most part, it keeps everything short enough that everything feels fun and fast-paced. It's just a pity that this game didn't get more attention.
I mean, with this design, Mutron-kun could have been a contender!
I mean, couldn't you see this guy hanging out with the likes of Mario and Sonic?
Very few things from when I was really young. I mean, really young. But I do remember Sinister, and how it gave me nightmares as a child. Like, big time. So much so that if I was at an arcade and I saw a Sinister machine, I'd actually avoid it like the damn plague. Yeah, you know, Freddy Krueger, Jason Voorhees, Mike Myers, fuck all of them, they ain't shit. But Sinister? Holy shit, he scared the piss out of me. Literally, which is another reason why I'd avoid the machine. Now I know what you're thinking.
Pembroke, how can an old arcade game scare anyone? What kind of pussy are you?
Well, I was a pretty big one. But that doesn't affect Sinistar. See, Sinistar is a space shooter where you would get attacked by this guy, Sinistar. He'd fly around quickly and eat your ship. Yum!
Red Robin!
Yum!
But it wasn't the fact that he was some sort of giant flying space skull that made him scary. No. It's because he would yell shit at you a lot, like,
"Beware, I live! Run, coward! And I hunger!"
Now, keep in mind, this was back in the early 80s. Video games typically didn't talk. And when they did, they'd sound all muffled or robotic like this.
I'm out of space. Ha 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 ha.
See, those don't sound remotely scary. Now listen to Sinistar.
I am Sinistar. Beware, I live. Run, run, run. Beware, coward. Run, coward. I hunger.
Holy shit, hear that voice? Not only is it a scary, booming voice, but it actually sounds really clear for a game in 1982. It's pretty impressive on a technical level, because minigames that would come after it, like Paperboy, wouldn't manage to sound anywhere near that clear.
That is flying. Don't tell my boss.
Yeah, listen to that garbled mess. It's like he's talking through a tuba. Now that I'm grown up, I don't think Sinistar is scary. I actually think he's pretty fucking awesome. All the dialogue and his look, complete with his eyebrow waggling, makes him a pretty memorable video game villain for anyone who's ever played this game.
Get in my belly!
But enough talking about Sinistar. Let's talk about the actual game he stars in. Sinistar plays a lot like the old game Asteroids, except on crack, and with more substance. And crack. Lots of crap. See, you drive a spaceship that seems to be stuck in high gear because you move really fucking fast in this game. If you're not careful, you can lose control of your ship and bounce all over the fucking place and have no idea of what you're doing or where you're going. Fortunately, there's a little map at the top that kind of helps you keep track of what's going on. Also, your ship seems to be made of some sort of high-grade rubber because unlike Asteroids, you can bump into shit all you want with no damage. Even the asteroids. But that's especially okay because it's actually part of the gameplay. See, these red enemies on the screen won't hurt you. They're just trying to find crystals so they can build Sinistar. But on your side, you know there's only one thing that can kill Sinistar, and that's Cinnabombs. I said Cinnabombs, not Cinnabons, dammit. Anyways, the only way you can make Cinnabombs is by getting the same crystals the enemies are after. You can get these crystals by shooting the asteroids and grabbing the little white dots that come out of it. And trust me, you'll have to make as many Cinnabombs as you can possibly get because it takes quite a few hits to take out Mr. Flying Space Skull. The past level, you have to destroy Sinistar, but you can't destroy him until the enemies finish building him. But don't worry, there's really much of a wait, because these enemies build fast and move even faster. It's like they're the evil version of Fix-It Felix. You can also find the unfinished Sinistar in the level and blow up his parts with Cinnabombs if you want, but it won't let you pass a level that way. All you end up doing is stalling the enemies and wasting a lot of time, since you can only pass a level by destroying him once he lives. And trust me, he'll let you know when he's alive, because you'll hear him shout.
Beware, I live.
Oh shit.
What you say?
Sinistar will chase you like Wile E. Coyote on speed, and you'll have to try your best to stay far enough away from him that he can't eat you, but close enough that you can still bomb him. It's a lot harder than it sounds. Once you defeat Sinistar, you go to the next level and repeat the same formula, just harder and faster with each level advance. And let me tell you, the game gets pretty damn tough from the start, and it never stops getting tougher.
Good night, sweet prince.
Other than the red guys that collect the crystals, there's also these flying turrets that will shoot at you, and they'll kill you. Fortunately, you can take them out with a simple shot, but be careful, they've got some great aim, even when you're flying all over the fucking galaxy. Fortunately, the designers of the game were nice enough to give us rapid fire guns at all times. See, since you need to practically always be shooting to kill baddies and mine for crystals, the game is set up to where you can just hold down the button and your ship will just shoot rapidly non-stop until you either let go of the button or get killed. This is a bigger blessing than you might realize, because back in this day, most games expected you to just hit the button repeatedly for each shot. I don't want to imagine how many people would get carpal tunnel syndrome if this game required you to just constantly tap the button. Admittedly, the fast pace of the game does take a little bit to get used to, and most likely you'll be confused when you first start playing it. But once you get the hang of it, you'll find that Sinistar is actually a quite enjoyable game. The constantly moving spaceship and just frantic nature of the game makes it an absolute blast to play. It also manages to be difficult without really being that frustrating. So if you haven't played Sinistar before, I'd highly recommend it. You can find it on a lot of arcade collections, and I bet once you try it, you'll hunger for more!
Hey, remember that Sun Wukong guy we talked about in the Sunset episode? Well, he's back! He's brought some friends. In the Technos beat 'em up, China Gate. Technos, for those who don't know him, are responsible for creating their most popular work, Double Dragon, which is the game that's credited for setting the template for beat 'em ups as we know them. Not to mention other beat 'em ups such as Renegade, Combat Tribes, and one of my personal favorites, River City Ransom. So, as I'm sure you've guessed, they're no strangers to the beat 'em up formula. And hey, a beat 'em up based on the Monkey King legend? That already sounds freaking awesome! What's interesting about the concept in this game is instead of scrolling to the right like in Double Dragon, most of the scrolling in China Gate is done upward as you climb up a rather tall tower beating up bad guys. Definitely unique among these types of games. Like Double Dragon, the game does allow for two players at the same time. Despite this, the game lets you pick between three characters from the Journey of the West story. Those characters are the monkey, the pig, and the Japanese demon known as a Kappa. The names they're given in the game are Goku, Hawkeye, and Jojo. Jojo? From what little story we're given, it looks like Blanka from Street Fighter 2 stole a library book and our heroes ain't gonna have it. Someone is gonna pay the late fees on that book and by golly, it won't be us. The art style in the game is strange, blocky, and kind of a super deformed chibi look. Despite being a monkey, Goku looks whiter than Vanilla Ice singing Bing Crosby songs. Even with the game's weird SD art style, a lot of the expressions the characters make when attacked reminds me a lot of Double Dragon. The game gives you a few basic combos and some aerial moves to attack the enemies with, but nothing near as deep as a majority of Technos' other beat-em-up games. There's also a few items you can attack with, but you can only use them once and quite frankly they're not very useful. But hey, at least Goku looks like he's having a fun time. All the enemies in the first level look like old men carrying spears and axes. While the art style does make them look kind of grotesque looking, they aren't really anything impressive. And you'll see a lot of them, which is kind of typical for this type of game. One of the things I found interesting in the game is if an enemy knocks you off the tower, you neither take damage nor does it take you back to the bottom of the tower. It just has your character fly back up on a magic cloud, which is another element from the Journey to the West story. Once you kill enough enemies, Blanka will appear as a boss. This gets us to one of the more irritating factors of this game. There is no temporary invincibility after you take damage. Even if you fly up from being knocked off the tower, once you get off the ground or jump off the cloud, which the game will make you do automatically if you don't do it yourself, the enemies will instantly attack you again and take more damage. Hell, even when you lose a life, this can happen. It doesn't give you a second to reorient yourself or get away from being beaten at all. So not only will the regular enemies gang up on you and drain all of your health as fast as possible, but the bosses are especially bad for doing insanely cheap attacks that get you as soon as you get to your feet. Which includes cornering you into an area where you can't fight back and they just continue to beat the monkey shit out of you until you lose a life. This isn't so bad with Blanka here, but it gets way worse with each new enemy and boss that you fight during the progression of this game. And I won't lie, this gets damn frustrating damn fast. Gotta die fast! Well, I defeated Blanka, but it seems that this is only the first part of level 1, and a library book is not to be found. Maybe Blanka lent it out to someone. Let's go to level 1 part 2 to find out. Well, in this area, we're attacked by SD swordsmen and zombie versions of the axe welders from the last level. And by zombie, I mean they're simply colored green. This early in the game, and they're already doing palette swaps. That can't be good. The boss of this area is a dual-wielding elf girl, who is so powerful that every motion in her walk cycle is a squat. Yeah, she's got no problems going to the bathroom.
Now your colon's open and ready for battle.
She's probably got the best character design in the game, and I'm not just saying that because she has breasts, because like all the other characters in this game, she's pretty unattractive to look at.
I just like the idea of an SD dual sword wielding elf as a stage boss. So even if it was a man, I still think it was pretty fucking awesome.
Go away, pussy. Go away, pussy.
Also, I found the best way to defeat this boss is to be just as cheap as she is. So get to the platform above her and just keep attacking her when she tries to jump up onto your level. You'll take her out in no time and maybe feel only a smidgen amount of guilt. The AI in this game might be cheap, but it sure ain't smart. Never thought the key to progress in this game would be simply be playing King of the Hill. Unfortunately, she doesn't have the book either, so we have to continue to level 2. Oh, I'm sorry. Mission 2. My bad. Mission 2 Part 1. Or Level 2 Part 1. Whatever, you guys know what I'm talking about. I don't think you're mission much. Well, with the exception of the weird gremlin guy attacking you with a mace, most of the enemies on this level are just reskins of previous enemies. Even going as far as attack you with recolors of the pig and kappa character you can play as in this game. This is when I realized that we're only on the first part of the second level, and this game is already running out of steam and creativity. The boss is some sort of multi-headed, multi-armed demon, and it's cheap as fuck! Because rather than trying to beat you up like previous enemies, this one can hurt you merely by touching you, as well as shooting projectiles that travel across the screen. This is really difficult since he can fly all over the fucking place, and can even hit you while you're in the middle of hitting him in an attack combo. He can also corner the shit out of you since he doesn't need platform. This style of enemy feels really out of place in this game. It feels less like a beat-em-up enemy and more like a boss you'd fight in a shoot-em-up like Gradius or R-Type.
Destroy the core.
This makes finding a strategy to fight this guy really difficult since he doesn't follow any of the rules set forth by previous enemies in this game, or any other beat-em-up for that matter. However, once you've managed to beat him, you'll see that he doesn't have the book either and you go to level 2 part 2. Level 2-2 if you will. This level gives us a really short tower and nothing but recolors. Even going as far as recoloring the elf girl and using her as a regular enemy. And the boss of this level? A recolor of Goku, the monkey character, because of course it is. You can dispatch him using the same method you used on elf girl by merely being on the higher ground and attacking him from there.
I have the high ground!
He doesn't have a book either, so let's go to Mission 3! And man, they really stopped giving a shit at this point. There's no towers, and you're stuck in a tiny room full of a bunch of Blanca recolors. Seriously, what happened with the developers in this game? Did Technos rush this out? Did the programmer just lose interest after level 1? Maybe level 1, 2? Why did this get so lazy so fast? Once you beat the Blancas, you're attacked by a boss, which this time is a reskin of the multi-head, multi-armed boss from Mission 2 Part 1, but even more cheap and difficult than before. Same problems occur, since he flies around, you can't really combo anything, merely touching him does damage, and he constantly corners you. If you manage to get enough hits on him, he'll actually start losing limbs from his body. Kinda interesting since you really don't see physical damage on bosses much in games of these days. Heck, you don't even see that much in games of modern day, now that I think about it. Knock off enough limbs and eventually he gets reduced to nothing but a flying head.
Crush its head.
Attack him even further and he becomes a brain. A brain?
Almost done, Big Mama Brain!
And this is where it gets really cheap. See, every time you attack the brain, it sends out this instant death goop at you. This is practically impossible to dodge because he attacks you while your sprite is still performing the animations of his attack. Therefore, you rarely get a chance to dodge this attack, and like I said, it's instant death goop, means one hit and you're dead. Giving a boss an instant death attack isn't anything new, but most games at least make it to where you have a conceivable way to dodge it. This is not the case here, as dodging this attack is impossible 99% of the time. And that's not even getting into the fact that it still has the attack methods of its previous form, aka hurting you by touching you and having projectiles that shoot clear across the room. Attack it enough time, and then it turns into this. Holy shit, things got Halloween in here all of a sudden. This thing is honestly terrifying looking.
Whoa, now this is good old-fashioned nightmare fuel.
As for its attacks, the attacks are just like the previous one, just more aggressive and way more cheap. They might as well call this boss Kraft because he's the cheesiest boss I've ever fought. Kill the boss and you finally get the library book. Weird that we got it back so early in this game. I wonder what they're gonna do next. I mean, I can't imagine them having a cheaper boss than... Oh. Oh, it's over. What? What?
It's over?
So this game only has 3, arguably 5 levels. What the fuck? Did they really get bored and burnt out so fast by making this game? That's incredibly short, even for an arcade game. Seriously, I don't think you understand. Even with the cheapness and constant continuing I had to do in this game, it still didn't even last longer than 30 minutes for me to do this entire playthrough. In fact, it took me exactly 21 minutes to beat this from game start to the credit roll. And much like most arcade games, once the credits finish rolling, you're taken back to the first level of the playthrough so you can do it again. No! To be honest, the only interesting thing about playing this game is it makes me really wonder what happened behind the scenes to cause this game to be so broken and unfinished. Was there some internal issues that caused this? Or did the designers and programmers just lose interest halfway? Wait, not even halfway through this game. I mean, seriously, what the fuck happened? As for the overall feeling of this game, it's honestly not very good. Like, at all. It's really bad. The first level of the game, despite its cheapness, actually felt pretty solid. But after that level, the game just takes a downward spiral of unfinished, cheap, lazy programming, and it's a real shame. If you see this game anywhere, even on MAME, I recommend not even bothering to look at it. Not only is it not worth your time, it's a horrible black stain on Technos' reputation. There's way better beat-em-ups out there by Technos, and there's way better video games based on the Monkey King. So ignore this one and play something more worth your time. I'd recommend Technos' Double Dragon, or Capcom's Sun Sun. Because in the long run, monkeying around with China Gate is just gonna hurt your brain.
When there's something strange in your neighborhood, who are you gonna call?
Well, not those guys.
Well, yeah, but I was thinking something more animated?
There we go. The real Ghostbusters is a cartoon based on the popular movie, well, the Ghostbusters, if you weren't able to get that from the title. As far as most cartoons based on movies go, this one's actually rather good, and even holds up pretty well by today's standards. And while most companies were making video games based on the movie license, our good pals Data East here came in and made us an arcade game based upon the cartoon. Weird that Deke doesn't get a credit on this, but I guess Columbia does own the franchise. Oh well. The game is set up to where up to 3 players can join in on what is more or less an overhead style on foot shoot 'em up. The way you attack the wide variety of ghosts and ghouls is definitely interesting. You have 2 manners of attack, the typical proton stream and some puny little shot blasts. The proton stream is stronger, but has limited use, while the shots are unlimited, but weaker. When you kill a monster, it turns into a harmless white ghost that can only be captured with the proton stream. Capturing the ghost will net you points and sometimes even power-ups. After capturing 100 of them, you'll get an extra life. Huh. Funny how collecting the souls of the dead can actually get you another chance at life. I guess that means they're like spiritual Mario coins? I don't know. There's a few power-ups to help you as well. The ghost traps will refill the proton stream. The Ghostbuster logo will power up the shot blasts. If you get enough of these, you can even make it stronger than the proton stream. However, like most games of this type, you lose all these power-ups if you die. Other power-ups include a temporary force field and Slimer. Force field is, well, obvious. However, Slimer works in a similar but different way. While Slimer doesn't make you completely invincible, he does attack enemies and block attacks that come in contact with him. The expression he makes when he hits an enemy makes him look like he's gotten the bad touch. Not sure how you'd give a ghost a bad touch, but someone figured it out. Ugh. Most of the time, Slimer just erratically circles you, but occasionally when you get him, he'll start zigzagging in your presence, like a 5-year-old who drank too many sodas. Okay, man, which one of you gave Slimer the giant cup of coffee? He's gonna be like this for days now! Or until I die. If there's anything I would complain about in this game, it's the sprite work on the Ghostbusters themselves. They're all generic, nondescript human graphics, with the only difference being the color of their outfits. Neither of which match the outfits worn in the show, and none of them resemble the characters from the show. If it wasn't for the proton streams and Slimer, you could easily pass this off as not even being a Ghostbusters game. And since all 3 characters are white, that means none of them are Winston. Poor Winston, always getting the crap into the stick when it comes to these Ghostbuster games. It would have been nice to have been able to pick which Ghostbuster you could have played as, each having their own stat and whatnot. Like, I mean, could you imagine that? Winston could have, like, the best strength stat, Egon could have the best intelligence stat, and Peter's sass stat would be through the roof!
Swell. I bet she looks like a tank and has a personality to match.
However, the game does make up for the lack of selectable characters by having a wide variety of creative enemies. Let's take a look at them. Literal death spikes. This is your brain on drugs. The Jersey Devil. The ghost of Mr. Snuffleupagus. Donald Trump's parents. Guess this is why Winston isn't in the game. The Toilet Paper Phantom. Ever wonder why you run out of toilet paper so fast? It's because of this guy. Snakes. Why'd it have to be snakes? Mudman. Vagina Nightmare. Stretch Vulture. Fish Face. Death Monkey. Bootylicious Death. I mean, damn, he's wearing a baggy cloak and that booty is still like, BAM!
Don't overlook my butt. I work out all the time, and reaping burns a lot of calories.
And the ghost of Simon Belmont.
To Simon Belmont, vampire hunter. Not to mention finder of lost dogs, pussycats, and loved ones.
And to be honest, that's only a small amount of what's in this game. Also, another neat factor in the game is the levels aren't completely straightforward, with each level often having multiple different paths you can take, allowing for a small bit of replay value, and you can try taking different routes to see which one's easier or which one has the most power-ups in it. So the question is this a good game? And I'd have to say, yes, most definitely. While it doesn't have the same level of presentation as many of Konami's cartoon-based arcade games like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles or The Simpsons, it still makes for a fun and fairly creative little shooter. I'd say give it a try, but I'd advise bringing a friend. That way you might have a ghost of a chance. Yeah. It's Halloween time. That means we need ghosts, monsters, or a haunted house. Oh hey, how about all of those at once? Welcome to Bogey Manor, a game that surprisingly has nothing to do with goth or monkeys. To be honest, I'm pretty sure the name of this game was meant to be a pun on the boogeyman, i.e. Bogey Manor. But an O is probably lost in translation. Probably for the better, because Bogey Manor doesn't sound much like a haunted house game either. It sounds more like a rhythm game. But that aside, Bogey Manor is a game that has you playing as Fritz, a bootleg Power Ranger out to rid the world of ghosts by destroying the actual haunted houses that they live in. Well, that's one way to do it. Busing might make you feel good, but so does Demolition, to be honest. Anyways, each game starts in a house that is 4 screens wide and 4 floors tall. Fortunately, all the floors are on each screen, and if you keep going left or right, the rooms will loop. There's a simplified map at the top to help keep track of where you are so you don't get lost. It also will blink if a monster off screen is close to you. Unfortunately, I find that I can never pay attention to both the map and what I'm doing on the screen at the same time, and I'll often run into an off screen enemy. Damn it, son of a penis wrinkle! Now, our man Fritz doesn't need no ghost-busting proton pack to stop ghosts. Oh no, he has a glow stick, and he will bash them in the head with it. Unfortunately, you can't just run up and bash most monsters in this game. No, they'll kill you if you do that. You have to be smart. You have to trick them by using the trick button on the machine. A button that, when pressed, literally just makes Fritz point in a random direction in a pose where you can obviously tell he's going, "Look over there!" Obviously, these ghosts are pretty old because they fall for this, and it's the oldest trick in the book. Once they're distracted, you can slam them in the head with the power pole and temporarily stun them, and walk right past them. But a warning, do this too many times and they will get pissed off and tricking them will no longer work. And boy, do they look pissed. Granted, if I fell for this trick multiple times, I'd be pretty pissed off too. The main objective to the game is to find all the crystals in the house and bash them with your stick. Bash crystal with your stick. Sounds like a bad Star Fox fan fiction, to be honest. Once you've succeeded at destroying all the crystals, the house will crumble and you have to escape to a blinking door to advance to the next stage. Who would have thought that destroying all these monsters' glassware was the secret to defeating them? Maybe I should have just gone to the kitchen and destroyed all their dishes first. I don't know who this girl is, but judging from her pose, she thinks that this is Bogey Manor as well. Now, one of the other gameplay mechanics in this game is that most levels will only let you see what's in the room you're in, with the others blacked out.
This gives a bit of challenge in finding where all the crystals are. If you manage to destroy all the red crystals in the house, a ring will appear. Getting it will allow all the rooms to light up and make finding crystals a lot easier. You can also get to other floors by either stairways or going into doors. The unfortunate thing about using doors is if there's multiple doors on the screen, you never know which door you're going to come out of. It's like a freaking episode of Scooby-Doo. However, if you break all of the green crystals, one of the doors will glow and entering it will turn you into a full-blown, almost legit Power Ranger. Go, go, Power Rangers! Go, go, Power Rangers! Go, go, Power Rangers! That's a lot of equipment you got there. A lot of equipment that actually isn't used in the game, because despite saying Fritz Laser, it's still just hitting them with a glow stick. Granted, now the glow stick actually defeats them straight up. No stun and no having to trick them. Also, this power-up allows you to defy physics by jumping up and down to each floor. Fuck floors! You can't stop, Super Fritz! Unfortunately, the power-up is only temporary. But in most cases, you can usually beat the stage once you're powered up. Though, it's worth mentioning you can get a score bonus for passing a level without using the power-up, for you peeps who actually care about points. Personally, I would rather power up and destroy shit. The enemies in this game consist of your usual variety of Halloween ghouls, like ghosts, Frankensteins, and witches. However, there are some unique enemies, like the evil Furbies, which is an oxymoron because we all know that Furbies are evil. Janitor monsters that will erase the doors. Hey, ghosts gotta keep their place clean too. Slimer, who will temporarily make you unable to attack. And the possessed Dana Barrett from Ghostbusters.
There is no Dana, only
Sue. On a random note, nothing looks more sad than a Frankenstein that fell for that look over there trick. Look at that defeated face. That's the face of a monster who can't believe he fell for this shit. I kinda feel bad for him.
Hello, darkness, my old friend.
There's only four styles to the levels in the game, but they only use the same background elements. The actual level design still changes as far as adding doors, crystal placement, holes in the floor, as well as increasing in the number and difficulty of the monsters in the level. And with that said, that's pretty much a majority of the game. It's a tough, unique, fun, and surprisingly obscure game. Honestly, I'm surprised this one isn't more well known, as I would have played the shit out of this had I saw it in an arcade, especially as a kid. I recommend giving it a look if you ever get a chance to play it. It's a ghoulish game with a sense of humor in it, which is kind of impressive for a game from the early 80s. I give it 3 out of 5 ghosts. And this is the place where I'd say goodbye with some sort of joke in tow, but
Hey, what's that outside the window? I just used the oldest trick in the book.
Ooh, what is it? I want to see. Hey, I don't want to miss anything.
Yeah, I can't believe she bought...
It's that time of year. Ghosts, ghouls, spooks, and an arcade game to review that has a Halloween-y atmosphere to it. What game did I pick this year? Why, it's Monster Bash, a graveyard smash! Monster Bash is a strange but interesting little game from everyone's favorite hedgehog milkers, Sega. Monster Bash has you playing as a little kid named Little Red, but his red and yellow color scheme makes him look less like a human child and more like a child born of fire. Kinda like he's a chibi version of the Human Torch. So I'm gonna call him, Little Torchy.
Tacos.
Anyways, Little Torchy is on a mission to kill the three greatest monsters in existence. Dracula, Frankenstein, and the Chameleon Man? Wait, what? Okay, you have two of the most famous monsters ever, Dracula and the Frankenstein Monster, and then for the third one you go with Chameleon Man? Who the fuck is Chameleon Man? Sega, you just made that up, didn't you? So what, you couldn't think of a third popular Universal monster lampoon? No mummy, no wolfman, no creature from the Black Lagoon? Nah, Chameleon Man, that's what you go with. Sure, whatever.
So how the game works is like this. You play as little Torchy, who has the ability to send out lightning bolts out of his hands called zaps. Totally the ability I expect from a kid that looks like he's on fire. These zaps can take out small enemies like bats, spiders, and werewolves? Wow, wait, werewolves don't get to be bosses in this game. They're lowered to just cannon fodder on the same level as bats and spiders? That's kind of sad, but I guess it's still a better treatment than they got in Twilight. Each level also has a big baddie like Drac, Frankie, Camille, but they can't be hurt with your puny zaps. You need something more powerful. You need cocaine. Nah, I'm just kidding. You just need to get the powerful super zap. How do you get this almighty ability, you ask? Well, let me tell you, random voice in my head that won't shut up. So at every level, there's what looks like a hilt of a sword. If you light up enough candles in the level, the sword will glow and touching it will give you the powerful super zap. The super zap is the only thing that can kill the big bads of the level. But be careful, you can only use it once. And if you fail, then you have to recharge the sword all over again. Somebody needs to get this sword to Energizer because it keeps going and going and going and going and going and going. If you hit the enemy with the super zap, you kill him and go to the next level. Oh, egads. That's a rather gruesome looking death for a 1982 arcade game. Fucking melted the asshole. Poor bastard. Now the game has three levels. Dracula's Mansion, Frankenstein's Castle, and Chameleon Man's Graveyard. Once you beat all three levels, you start them all over again, except the enemies are harder and faster, tis the tradition of these older games. Also, each level kind of has its own little gimmick to it. Dracula's Mansion has warping doors that can take Dracula or you to the top or bottom of the levels. Frankenstein's level, which, by the way, I know the monster isn't called Frankenstein, he's called Frankenstein's Monster. You serious Frankenstein fans get really pissy over this, so I figured I should just mention it before you Frankies start posting angry comments below. If you, you know, haven't already. But yes, this game, like many things, incorrectly call him Frankenstein, so I'm going to do that too, just to be consistent with the game. Anywho, in Frankie's level, you have these little holes that you can use to drop down floors really fast. In Chameleon Man's Graveyard, the game suddenly goes from a side perspective to an overhead perspective, and you have buttons of three colors that you can use to change the various gates in the graveyard to help you reach areas and block baddies. The buttons also change the color of the backdrop, and doing this is helpful because if you don't, Chameleon Man will start to blend in with the background and turn invisible. And once he's invisible, you can't hurt him with your super zaps. So keep these colors changing like a malfunctioning streetlight. Kill the Chameleon Man and then get ready to do it all over again. Second verse, same as the first, but a whole lot harder and a whole lot worse. You know, I'm actually not sure about that. From what I see, it looks like these monsters are just minding their own business, chilling at their home, when little Torchy just busts in and kills them. I mean, in the later loops, the big bads practically run away from you. Who is the real monster here? It's man. It's always man. The real monster's always man. I mean, look at little Torchy. Shaking his ass around after killing a monster? What a fucking sicko. Not to mention, it's just plain rude. You're the true monster, little Torchy. Leave these Draculas alone. Frankie, too. But go ahead and kill Chameleon Man. Might be a mercy killing. Personally, I'd rather be dead than living in a graveyard. Just saying. So the overall question is Monster Bash a good game? And I'd say, eh. It's a pretty interesting game with some pretty good graphics for 1982, but it's only somewhat fun for like the first loop, and then it just gets really frustrating really fast. Overall, I'll give it a 2 out of 5 Draculas. In the long run, instead of playing Monster Bash, I think I'd just rather do the Monster Mash. It's that time of year again. Ghosts, bats, and black cats are out tonight. With that said, it's time to review a new spoopy arcade game. What game this time, you might ask? Well, it's the 1986 Exidy arcade game, Chiller. Yeah, you remember Exidy. They made, that Mousetrap game I reviewed a couple years ago. Yeah. Chiller is a rather interesting piece of gaming from the mid-80s, in the fact that it's pretty damn gory for a game made in that day and age. And possibly too gory, as it's sold poorly in America, because few arcades wanted it in their establishment, claiming that it was too much.
Too much!
Which makes sense considering the high amount of children that were frequenting arcades at that time. But what makes Chiller so bad? Let's
take a look and find out. For starters, every time I put a coin in this game, we get this ghostly wailing. At least, I think that's what it's supposed to be. Honestly, it sounds more like Boris Karloff having an orgasm. The gameplay in this game is kind of a horror-themed shooting gallery of sorts, as you use a rifle-mounted light gun to shoot various on-screen targets. And by targets, I mean tortured innocent humans. Yep, that's right, you get to torture people in this game. Yeah, I think these guys walked into the wrong BDSM club. Yeah, the first two levels have you shooting victims, blowing off chunks of their flesh, or you can shoot handles and triggers to get them killed by various torture devices, such as guillotines, stretch racks, and even a head crusher. Yeah, I feel you, man. I have sinus headaches that feel like that all the time. The only difference is you get the sweet release of death. So lucky. The way each level works is you're given a monster meter with a number on it, and it's your job to shoot enough objects to reduce the monster meter to zero. Sounds easy, right? Well, it's not, because you also have a time limit to complete this in, or else the game is over. So you're gonna have to shoot faster than Optimus Prime at a Decepticon convention. However, it's worth mentioning that only two out of the four levels in the game revolve around torture. The other two levels are more just horror themed. Third level is a spooky hallway with a lady being chased by a weird floating head whose eye will pop out when you shoot him. Ew. Might want to get some ice for that. What I find weird about this level is after two levels of shooting and torturing innocent victims, they won't let you shoot and kill this lady. I mean, I don't condone shooting innocent people, but it does make understanding the game's own logic and morals a little confusing. Oh well, at least you could drop her down a trapdoor easy enough. There's also this wolf that it won't let you kill too. I guess it's only fair, all he wants to do is pick up the random body parts that litter the hallway. So leave this wolf alone. He's just providing janitorial services for this place. He's doing his best, he doesn't need you effing shooting him, you big meanie. I also want to mention this is by far the hardest level in the entire game. Mostly because it has way more moving targets than the rest of the levels, plus the transparency effect on the ghost doesn't exactly make them the easiest to see, therefore shoot. Come on, give these guys a little darker color so at least then I'll have a ghost of a chance. And why the hell is there a mummy in a normal cheap wooden coffin? Guess King Titty Common wanted to live like a peasant for a day. The last level is a graveyard that has undead zombies, a hooded priest with a wheelbarrow full of body parts, and pixelated nudity. Yeah, I'm not gonna show it, but there's a female zombie that you can shoot to remove her clothes and get some hot pixelated 8-bit titty. Yeah. To be all serious, it's nothing really enticing or worth looking at, but if that's your thing, hey, I don't judge. Also, why the fuck is this tombstone spraying blood when I shoot it? Did I find Dracula's hidden blood rations or something? Also, this tombstone says Vic when I shoot it. Either we found the grave for the Vic-20 or we found Vic Mignogna's dignity. Either way, it's something that's been long dead. After level 4, the levels will restart, but to keep this from getting boring, the game has an interesting additional gameplay element to it. Before each level, there's a list of special items the game would like you to find and shoot. If you manage to shoot them all, it will take you to a slot machine mini game where you get a chance at winning a free game. If you don't get all of them, don't worry about it. It will count the ones you did get and let you try to find the rest of them the next time you play that level. Some of these items are visible from the start and easy to find, while others are hidden and require you to shoot just the right brick or floor tile to reveal them. Finding these can be both fun and frustrating, considering you have to do this while still shooting enough things on the screen to pass the level. So you're not exactly given a lot of time to shoot random floor tiles and bricks. Some people out there may ask, where in the world is Carmen Sandiego? But I ask, where the fuck is this damn key? Every time you find one of the needed items, it will remove it from a picture, eventually revealing a picture of a haunted mansion. And once all the pieces are gone, you get to go to a new bonus level where you shoot decapitated heads and human organs. Lovely. Well, I guess you can at least say this game has heart. So yeah, Chiller is a weird game for 1986 and pretty disturbing for the time. Hell, the game's focus on torturing people in the first two levels actually still make it kind of disturbing when you think about it. But you want to know what's really weird? This game actually got an NES port. Yep, you can play Chiller on the good old Nintendo Entertainment System. It's slightly censored, but it still has the torture rooms and torture devices in it. Granted, this cartridge wasn't licensed by Nintendo and was one of those unlicensed
licensed games, but it's still weird that this got a port, even if it wasn't sanctioned by Nintendo. But hey, at least those damn ghosts are way more visible in this version, thank God. With all that said and done, the question would be, is Chiller a good game? And I'd say, it's okay. If the imagery and needless violence doesn't bother you, then you can actually get some fun out of this game. Though with only 4 levels, it can get kind of repetitive and dull after a few playthroughs. So overall, I'm gonna give Chiller 3 out of 5 hearts. If you're into gore, you might have some fun, but otherwise you might find playing this game to be torture.